choose your own adventure books were very popular. You'd read along in the book until you came to a fork in the road, so to speak, a fork in the story, and then you would choose what to do next. Here's an example from the second book of the series, Journey Under the Sea. Carefully maneuvering the seeker between the walls of the ocean canyon, you discover a huge, round hole. A stream of large bubbles flows steadily out of the hill of the hole. The seeker is equipped with scientific equipment to analyze the bubbles. It also has sonar equipment to measure the depth. Who knows where this hole might lead? If you decide to analyze the bubbles, turn to page 9. If you decide to measure the depth, turn to page 14. These books taught us that there is power and there is chance in the choices we make. That not everything is in our control, but that we do make decisions along the way. Of course, the author still has a lot of say in where my decision leads next. But we participate in the trajectory the story takes. This morning we heard two stories. Two stories with very different trajectories. In the first one, King David. King David, you remember, our underdog hero, slingshot-wielding, giant-conquering shepherd boy turned king. This King David falls a bit from his pedestal when he does something uncomfortably human. He lets his power go to his head, and he misuses it selfishly rather than for the good of all, rather than for the good of his people. Of course, today we see a huge problem in the fact that David treats a woman, Bathsheba, as an object, as something to use and abuse. That's a whole other layer of sin that likely wasn't recognized by the story's first hearers. What they would have taken issue with is that David uses his power to steal, use, and abuse another man's wife. And not just any man, but one who is deeply loyal to him, someone who is out fighting to secure David's throne, out fighting to protect the freedoms and autonomy of the whole Hebrew people, a man named Uriah. And in this moment of weakness and desire and lust, David does something offensive to his own people's sense of right and wrong, and even more offensive to our 21st century moral compass. It's a regrettable decision. It's one that turns David in a very different direction from the surprising and remarkable direction God has been leading him, from shepherd boy to king. At least that's how we usually tell the story. But the truth is, it wasn't just one decision. It was decision after decision after decision that spiraled this trajectory out in David's life. If we were to read it as a choose-your-own-adventure novel, it would go something like this. The Israelite troops are heading out to battle. Do you choose to lead them as their king, or do you stay safely behind and send them out alone? Send them out alone. Looking out from your home set high above all of the other homes, you see a beautiful woman bathing on a rooftop. Do you choose to do nothing or find out more about her? Find out more about her. The woman is married to one of their officers, Uriah the Hittite. One of your officers that you just sent out alone to fight your battles for you. Do you choose to show your loyalty to your officer and use your power to honor him? Or do you choose to take advantage of his absence and use your power to take, use, and abuse this woman, his wife? Take this woman. The woman becomes pregnant. Do you leave her husband, your officer, out in the battlefield, allowing him to come back and discover that you have impregnated his wife? Or do you call him back, hoping he goes to his wife and that he claims the child as his own then? Call him back. Uriah returns from the field, but does not sleep with his wife, out of solidarity for his men who are not with their wives. Do you send him back to the field, or do you have him stay another night and try to get him drunk so that he will stay the night with his wife? Have him stay another night. He does get drunk, but he still doesn't go to his wife. Do you send him back to his post, knowing that he will find out that you have pregnant his wife? Or do you change his orders and put him in a situation where he will surely be killed? Put him in a situation where he will surely be killed. You see, all along the way, with each decision, David sent his life spiraling in a direction he did not want to go. At some point, I'm sure, he fell back into a corner, felt like he had no other option but to keep spiraling. As is often the case when we try to cover up our poor decisions rather than face them head on and face the consequences, David's cover-up becomes even more of a sinful mess than that original poor decision. We learn that not only does Uriah die, but many more in David's army die as well. Because in order for Joab to put him in a situation where he will surely die, he has to put many other men in that situation as well. In other words, David literally sacrifices other people on his own altar to protect himself from the consequences of his own actions. Sometimes I wonder if the animal sacrificial system to atone for sins that we read about in the Bible was in part a way to remind the people that the decisions and the trajectories they set for their lives do have consequences of life and death for others. Now, not all of the consequences of our actions result in something as extreme as death for someone else. But many of them do affect others. And many times, our cover-up of those decisions does come at cost to someone else. And when the consequences to our actions begin to spiral out, it can feel very hard to change that trajectory. Now, in David's case, eventually, with the help of God, because all things are possible with God, after a lot of honesty and prayer and some very clear repentance and turning back toward the heart of God, the trajectory of David's life will turn. It will turn again in a positive direction. That downward spiral will change course, but not after some irreversible loss and some unnecessary deaths. Now, the second story we heard this morning, that you heard from Debbie and you also heard from me during the child in us all, is a very different story. And if you were to read this as a choose-your-own-adventure, it would be far shorter, but it would go something like this. Jesus sees a crowd in the middle of nowhere, and he asks his disciples how they're going to feed all of these people. You know you only have a small amount of food that likely won't stretch to feed everyone, and you're very hungry yourself. Do Do you choose to offer your fish and loaves of bread? Or do you keep them and eat them for yourself? Offer them. Jesus takes your bread, blesses it, and breaks it, and passes it around. Everyone shares your food and eats, full of joy. And when they are done, they collect 12 baskets of leftovers. Now, we don't know in this story if the food actually multiplied, breaking our understanding of the laws of nature. Or if, as this boy began to share his food, others started to share their food as well. What we see is that God takes this small decision of this boy and begins pulling it into a spiral of abundance. Frederick Buechner writes of miracles. A miracle is when the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. A miracle is when 1 + 1 = 1,000. Often that's what we discover when we decide to start taking small steps towards God's heart. When we decide to start taking small steps to live into and live out God's love for all of creation. It turns into something beyond our wildest imaginings. We participate. We help set the trajectory. And God takes it the distance. This boy in the story, who offers his fish and his loaves, he may not have received any more bread or fish than he would have if he had kept it for himself. Maybe he received less. It was the others. It was the wider community that received the abundance and the blessing that resulted from the decision he made. It's very similar, though the opposite, of course, from what happens to David, where so many others paid the price for his decision. We know, after all, that it is true, isn't it, that we as a global community have enough food to go around, that there are enough resources for everyone, especially when coupled with some creative ingenuity. Sometimes a miracle is not when God gives extra. But when God inspires us to come together as a community and share what we have, to set a different trajectory and a different course for our life together. C.S. Lewis writes about miracles. Miracles are a retelling in small letters of the very same story which is written across the whole universe in letters too large for some of us. What's that story? That there is enough to go around. That any trajectory, no matter how hopeless or impossible, can be turned. That God takes our participation and multiplies it out beyond our wildest imaginings. That was certainly what David discovered. As those of us know who read David's story, David's firstborn son by Bathsheba, the son made out of this decision, is very ill when he is born and dies shortly after. And when he is ill, David and his advisor, the prophet Nathan, they both interpret this as that it must be God's punishment for David's poor decision. And David fervently prays and fasts and asks forgiveness, hoping that his son will be spared. Of course, thinking that your child's illness is punishment from God is not particularly great theology. Jesus helped people to see that illnesses and childhood disabilities were not the result of their parents' sin. But we can only imagine how David's grief had added to the shame and guilt he already felt. Perhaps David thought he deserved this. Certainly, all combined, David must have felt at absolute rock bottom. And it becomes this huge turning point for him. A very different kind of turning point than the turning point when he saw Bathsheba on the roof and decided to act. David uses his grief and uses that rock bottom place to begin making decisions to change the trajectory of his life. His relationship with Bathsheba turns from one of abuse and using her as an object to loving and valuing her as a human being and now as his spouse. David, after some very heartfelt praying and repenting, he goes to comfort his grieving wife. And they conceive another son, Solomon. And God takes these small decisions and these small acts that David makes. Something as simple as honest repentance and fasting and prayer and comforting his spouse. This very small change in trajectory. God takes it and spirals it back into abundance. The boy Solomon will become David's heir, a king who will be known for his wisdom, perhaps a wisdom learned from watching his father work through his mistakes. The whole Hebrew people will be blessed by him. On Thursday, the Presbytery of Tampa Bay met, and Mickey Moore was aware of myself when I attended the meeting. The new coaching coordinator of the Presbytery, Patrice Hadley, had invited the executive presbyter of the South Atlantic, an African-American minister who lives in Charleston, to come and preach for us in the morning. And in the afternoon, we as a presbytery held a sacred conversation on race, where he and several others sat on a panel, including our own Gene Cooley. And they talked about their personal experiences of race relations in America. They talked about where they see hope and how it could be possible for us to turn our trajectory as a nation. I really loved something that Jean Cooley said. She said, if you are born white in America, you can't be anything other than a recovering racist. She said that because white privilege is so ingrained and so systemic and so subtle and so unconscious. And when asked to give an example of when she's been a racist in recovery, she talked about a man in her and Bill's congregation quite a while ago who would go around trembling and mumbling. And she assumed that he must be a janitor or something along those lines. But as she discovered, Dr. So-and-so, and I don't remember the name, Bill probably does, he was a brilliant, if absent-minded and mumbling, professor at a local college. I'll share one of my own stories as well. About 2 years into seminary, I realized that I was avoiding the black students on campus. I didn't sit with them at meals. I wouldn't strike up conversations with them in class. I slipped quietly past them, try not to make eye contact. Why? Well, as I realized from reflecting, it was because many of the African American students on campus came from a Baptist or a more conservative background, and I was worried that they wouldn't accept or affirm or love or welcome me as a gay person. Now, there were plenty of white Baptist students as well. But my survival instincts kicked in, and I wanted to simply lump together this group of people based on nothing else than the color of their skin. I was not proud of that. I'm not proud of the way I have participated in setting a trajectory, a of a system that is literally costing Black Americans their lives, causing them to shout out to all of us, Black lives matter too. I'm not proud of that, just as I'm not proud of the moments when I have seen someone in need and decided to hoard my resources for myself. Or those times when I have looked at the staggering statistics about the trajectory of our environment and felt overwhelmed and thought my little actions, my decisions, they won't make a difference. Because you see these thought patterns reveal how much my faith still needs to grow and continues to grow. My faith in God to take my little participation and swirl it out into abundance, but also my faith in myself, my faith in my own freedom and volition, not to simply be caught in a downward spiral, forced to make one bad decision after the next, but instead as someone who can turn, someone who can repent, someone who can change course with God's help. David, I'm sure, as I said, felt backed into a corner at times. But he had choices. He had options. Just as that boy did when he made the decision that became miraculous to share his meal and build the beloved community. So what adventure are you choosing? What spirals are you participating in? Spirals of destruction or spirals of abundance and life? Because our faith proclaims that God can break us out of those spirals of destruction and change the trajectory of our life together. Our faith proclaims that God can use those small actions, few pink fish and loaves, the small decisions to build the beloved community and bless others abundantly. Jesus gave his disciples only a few instructions. Two of them were, follow me and have faith. Because Jesus knew how to break out of those spirals of destruction, and Jesus knew how to participate in those spirals of abundance. There is so much in our lives that we can't control, but there are those forks in the road, those forks in our story, when we can turn towards the heart of God or away from it. God, help us as we follow Jesus, as we have faith, as we try to live in life-giving ways. Amen.